God has given us wheat and grapes, and we human beings have done something with them that only humans can do. We have made them into bread and wine. We will take the bread and wine and then offer them back to God in the divine liturgy, placing them on the altar during the great entrance. Then, having received our gifts, God will return them to us once again as an even greater blessing, his very body and blood, nourishing us with them both physically and spiritually. And our response is, again, something only humans can offer to God, that is thanksgiving. In fact, the very word Eucharist means thanksgiving. This morning, the minded Archpriest Michael Margitis, who lies before us, takes part in this cycle of thanksgiving one last time. You will have noticed Father Michael's face is covered with an air, the special cloth that is used to cover the holy gifts offered during the Divine Liturgy. Like the wheat and the grapes, God gave us the gift of Michael Margitis 88 years ago when he was born in Shenandoah, Pennsylvania. Much like the wheat and grapes that were made into bread and wine, Michael Margitis was transformed, shaped, and molded by his parents and his community around him into an exemplary young man. He was then educated at St. Vladimir Seminary and at Columbia University, married to his wife, Eleanor, and then ordained a deacon. Then, 64 years ago, when I was 1 year old, Deacon Michael Margitis was ordained a priest. Just as the bread and wine are returned to God during the Divine Liturgy, the deacon Michael Margitis was offered to God and taken out into the center of the church at the Great Entrance under that very same air that covers his face. He was, in effect, the final gift offered to God that morning during the Divine Liturgy. And with all our gifts offered to God, Father Michael was received at the altar and then returned to us once again as a priest. And today we return him back to God. Father Michael was ordained for one purpose and one purpose only. And that is to be a living icon of Christ among us. He was not ordained to sweep the parking lot, though he may have swept the parking lot. He was not ordained to collect money for the building fund, and we all know he did that. He was not ordained that is set apart for any other reason but to make Christ present among us. And he did that so very well. His ears that heard confessions were the ears of Christ. His lips that pronounced the good news of the gospel were the lips of Christ. The hands that gave blessings were the hands of Christ. When I think about Father Michael, I'm reminded not only of his sacrificial ministry, but of his vision. The prophet Isaiah said that the people perish without a vision. And perhaps today, we as a nation have lost our vision and our way as well. But back to Father Michael. As I've said this many times, I remember that particular day when Father Michael and his son, Larry, presented Bishop Tika with their vision of this church in which we stand this morning. In those days, the Holy Protection Rush North of our church was a very small community, somewhat bruised from those little squabbles that happened far too often in the areas, that in human terms looked as though it did not have much of a chance at a future. But Father Michael had a vision. He had a plan to build this temple. Build this church. In using the word church, I'm not only speaking of the building, but also the community that worships within it. Because the present temple in which we stand this morning is a reflection of a community that was healed of its wounds and nurtured back into a healthy family. The little wooden structure on Mountain View became this beautiful reflection of the kingdom of God. This could not have happened without God's blessing, without that young man who was raised by his parents and community and ordained a priest. who was possessed of such a vision. Last night, as I said, we send the mighty Archbishop Michael forth, and he is remembered, and as we sang this, that he remembered the possible light when we stand in the temple holding candles that recall the light of life that is within every one of us. Life that is transformed by Christ's empty tomb. I thought it rather appropriate that the frescoes being painted in the church that he loved so much at this time were those of the resurrection. And among the hymns sung last night were those odes of the canon of Holy Saturday. And at least for me, that canon is the liturgical harbinger of the possible night to come. Of old, thou didst bury the pursuing pirate beneath the waves of the sea. Now the children of those who were saved bury thee beneath the earth. But wife, the maiden, that is saved to the Lord, for gloriously has he been glorified. And do not lament me, O mother, seeing me in the tomb, the son conceived in the womb without seed. For I shall arise and be glorified with eternal glory as God. I shall exalt all who magnify you with faith and with love. Today we will bury the mighty Archbishop Michael beneath the earth. We will lament his passing as we see him in the tomb. But we will bury him knowing he will rise on the last day and be numbered among the righteous. And so this morning, I give thanks to God for the gift of the mighty Archbishop Michael Markievicz, who now stands before the heavenly altar, experiencing the eternal liturgy with the angels and the saints. Amen.